Hello everyone, this is Bala Vigneswaran from Thayagam Tamil Broadcasting Service. We are going to have an interesting program tonight. We'd like you to listen to this closely. The program is going to be in English. We appreciate your understanding that this program has to be in English. In the Nihalchi, Tamilil Ippodu Irukadu, Angilathil Mattume Oliparappagum, Pinnar Idan Thogupu Tamilil Valangapadum Endradai Chollikondu Indraya Nihalchiyai Aarambikkalam. We welcome our listeners from all over the world to Thayagam Tamil Radio. We are going to have a guest from Sri Lanka. We are going to connect him first and we'll continue this conversation. We have Kushil Gunasekera, a philanthropist, a businessman, and a good man. We are pleased to have him here, and it's our honor to have you with us, Kushil. Good afternoon.
Good afternoon. Thank you very much for inviting me.
So, first of all, we welcome to Thayagam Tamil Radio, and it's a radio that goes around the world 24 hours a day, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, and we have listeners from all over the world, although they are predominantly Tamil-speaking people. This conversation will be in English so that we can have a brief and a complete one. Then we will give them a summary. இந்த உரையாடல் ஆங்கிலத்தில் இருக்கும். இதன் தொகுப்பு உங்களுக்கு பின்னர் தரப்படும் என்பதை சொல்லிக்கொண்டே இந்த உரையாடலை ஆரம்பிக்கிறோம். Kushil, thanks again. You are in Australia. This definitely wouldn't be your first visit. How is Australia?
Well, I love Australia. This is about my probably 38th visit. You know, since 1992, never thought I'll get so, you know, coming over to Australia very frequently. Never did I think when I actually came for the first time in 1992, but it so happened that my work took me out here, and there's a lot of collaboration between Australia and Sri Lanka. So, especially with the Foundation of Goodness, our biggest network is right now in Australia. So, and the amount of help that we've got, you know, being a very benevolent nation, has been pretty remarkable and very praiseworthy. So I commend all of the Australian public for, you know, helping disadvantaged communities who are struggling out there with lots of hardships to overcome, giving
May I give me a second, Kushil? Can you speak again? There may be some volume. Can you say again, Kushil?
Yeah, okay. So,
Probably the first part of the conversation people wouldn't have had listened to. So can you start again if you don't mind, please? Yeah. This is your 38th visit to Australia. Let's go back.
Yeah, I mean, when I started coming here in 1992 for the World Cup final between Pakistan and England, I never could imagine that I would be visiting this frequently, you know, the benevolent nation of Australia. It's just the Foundation of Goodness work, especially post-tsunami, got into another kind of dimension where we had so many of them supporting us, you know, nationwide. So it's been truly
to say the least. So, yeah, you know, it's been very productive, meaningful, and you know, really captivating. So, I'm pleased to be here, and thank you for inviting me again. I'm not sure whether you have any technical errors, but I hope it's people can hear me out. So,
the initial part. Probably because, I mean, we did a little bit of software work yesterday and day before, so right. The initial conversation probably was a bit rusty, but yeah, we are fully in, so we can continue. Let's go back before we talk about the Foundation of Goodness in detail. You're born in an affluent family. Your father was a solicitor, and you're studying in our big schools, and Colombo was your regular place. But you're traveling between your small hometown and Colombo. And some observations, really, observations from your childhood shaped your life. And before go into it, the natives, exactly how, you know, that came into your mind. And before you go in, probably you want to get a sip of water, and we'll continue. So we're going to talk about your early days. So we are setting a couple of things up. We'll join you soon. Kushil, yeah, go ahead.
Yeah, you know, when I was you know, studying in Colombo at Ananda College, you know, I was kind of traveling between, I mean, I was in a boarding school, of course, but whenever I came back to my village in Sinigama, a rural kind of backdrop again, in the southern province, close to Gol and Ecuador, you know, I realized that the disparity that exists between the urban and rural sector was so far and wide. You know, there's lots of disparity, you know, but yet the kids and the youth from, you know, some of the rural villages that I worked with at the very beginning, especially my village in Sinigana, they were very smart, clever, brighter, skillful, talented, and, you know, had the potential definitely more than me. Because I played some, you know, sports, especially cricket and hockey and basketball. You know, cricket is like a religion in Sri Lanka, as you know. I don't need to elaborate on that. But and I, since probably I spoke some decent English, I was making inroads, whereas those who were far more talented and skillful than I was not making the same progress, because I think they didn't have the opportunity to pursue, you know, their careers, nor the training, or the facilities, or the exposure that I had. So, you know, I planted the seed that one day, whenever I have the means, I'm going to come back to my village and provide the same opportunities that I, you know, inherited. And then from there was no, you know, looking back, because every time I came back, I wanted to make something happen. And gradually, you know, this compassionate wish, the aspiration with being human, you know, started to unfold gradually. Nothing ever great is achieved without taking that first step at a time. And I think, however young I was, I wanted to make that difference, to give equality to those. You know, firstly, I thought of my village and the two villages adjoining. And that's how I actually started. But once I got into my business of trading sugar at the time, you know, I was able to accelerate the process and get back to my village. And then, you know, started the Foundation of Goodness in 1999.
The Foundation of Goodness has grown big, big and big. But it should have started from a drop. It should have started with a small project. There are a lot to do. I mean, as they say, in a third world like Sri Lanka, third world country like Sri Lanka, nothing is too big, nothing is too small. You can accommodate anything you have, and there is enough need. So thinking of that, which was your first project with respect to a charity, or with respect to empowerment, with respect to help somebody? As a young boy, you'd have done a few things, you know, help a poor man to get a meal or something. But as a substantial something, which was your first project that counts?
I think what I can't forget is my mother told me that at the age of 10, when someone in need appeared at the front gate, I was willing to share my lunch. That was probably, you know, I couldn't remember, but my mother reminded me. And I think, you know, I have that quality of compassion and kindness ingrained in me. So I was always willing to care and share, as I remember from my very young days. And but the question you asked, and if I am to answer, you know, I went into rural schools, especially the rural school that was in our village. Mm. And when you go into a rural school, you kind of, you know, comprehend all of the issues that are engulfing, you know, villages, because, you know, kids come to school without wearing shoes or not taking a backpack, or, you know, one book sometimes write 8 subjects. And a lot of the parents at the time didn't have, you know, pipe-borne water or electricity in their home. So that touched many chords in my heart, and, you know, I wanted to gradually do what I can. And then, you know, things started to unleash one by one, like you said. And, you know, a lot of people seeing what I do started to join me, even in small measure. And, you know, I kept the momentum. It's about making things happen, you know. So seeing the plight of others, I think, defines compassion. And I kept going, you know, and mainly, you know, it was humane, a lot of purity of intention, not expecting anything in return. Just the feeling of wanting to help others made me work harder. You know, to that end, I was very lucky that everything was going according to plan. But when I set up the Foundation of Goodness in 1999, you know, I had a small budget to work with. You know, I still remember the budgets were like, you know, doing $1,000 a month was really something great at the time. And probably the rupee was 75 to a dollar. So, and I think I did probably $12,000 a year, which is about 900,000 rupees. And the growth since then is like $125,000 a month, you know, going up to, you know, about $1.5 million a year. So it's grown in a way that I can't even imagine. Or sometimes I fail to, you know, understand exactly the way it has grown so fast. But I think when your intentions are pure and, you know, you want to do something human, there is some probably divinity that actually drives you to keep going no matter what, you know. So you're not looking at budgets, but you just look at, you know, people struggling in desperate circumstances, hardships, and, you know, you just keep moving. So and nothing multiplies so much as kindness. And I have always realized that goodness is the one investment that never fails. So
sometimes to do that kind of stuff, you must have a good heart. Doesn't cost much, right? Okay. I mean, the foundation has started, and you're going to do a few things. 2004 made a big hit on you, on the country. I was in Sri Lanka at that time. After a long time, I went to Sri Lanka. I was in the northern coast, and the tsunami was not far from us. But your foundation went big all around the country, around the coastal area. And how tsunami hit you at that time, Kushil?
Yeah, you know, on that day, I was actually planning on a scholarship program for 100 kids. And actually, Murali was the chief guest. And because they like to see celebrities, and, you know, so I was there at home planning this delivery of, you know, 100, you know, scholarships to these kids. And at 9:33 in the morning, the function was at 10, and then Murali called up and said that he cannot come on time. And that was the first time he actually didn't arrive on time, because he's normally about 15 minutes ahead of for any function, because that day his fiance from India was coming and the two mothers wanted to join. So that's how he escaped. And, you know, people were running inland saying that the sea is coming, and I had no idea what that meant. And I ran to the gate from the porch and took a turn towards the right, where the sea, you know, is 200 meters away from the villa. And I saw this 3-foot wave, you know, taking the escape route with, you know, the elderly, like body surfing, you know, being washed away. And then I had that kind of, you know, sixth sense where to run. And then I picked up the kids who were at my community center. and started to run with them. They were about 30 at the time. The waters were catching up, you know, so had some obstacles on the way, but somehow managed to get through to higher ground, where in those areas, all of the temples are located on, you know, higher elevation. So managed to kind of, except for one, everyone else was secure and safe. So, and, you know, 20 minutes later, the 30-foot waves rolled into the village. And even if you go now to my village and my villa that I gifted has 12 feet of water, the mark that's still retained. So it was a battle on your hands from that time. I had two choices to make, either to leave everything and go away, or say, no, I'm going to, you know, be with my villagers, resurrect them, and continue the journey, however tough it is. You know, sometimes adversity brings many blessings.
Yeah.
And, you know, you can't reverse what happens, and then you have to stay positive, look ahead, and do the best you can. So that's what I did. And I was at the, you know, temple, you know, with hundreds of people, you know, like funerals, crying out for losing their loved ones. And no one knew how this has happened. No one heard of a tsunami before.
I never heard of
other than a tidal wave. So, you know, it just took me about probably 6 to 8 hours to get away from the village, because the waters were still around. And, you know, in our village, or villages in that belt were hit very badly because we were traditionally coral miners.
Mm.
So because we were breaking the corals, there was no resistance or breakwater. So the waves hit you hard, because subsequent research showed that, you know, wherever there was coral intact, I think the waves went up to about 500 meters or so. So the story went that we ate from the sea and the sea ate us.
Mm.
You know, we destroyed the sea and the sea destroyed us, to put it in a, you know,
yeah,
in perspective.
Way.
Yeah. So, and I had to wade through so many bodies. I recall very tragic and, you know, gruesome to see, very, very moving, you know, tears in your eyes. So you just took a, you know, somehow had to wade waters and just get to, you know, your destination. So it was kind of hiking to get to Colombo, where I live. And probably I arrived at home 3 o'clock in the morning for my mother to be very, very pleased and happy that I arrived.
Yeah, still alive.
So, yeah, and from there, Bara, the journey began. That's how it started.
The tsunami started. The tsunami in you.
Yeah, I mean, you know, I thought the waves of compassion globally, we were able to overpower the waves of destruction and put together something really solid, which has now grown beyond my imagination.
Mm.
So it's because I think we did it with accountability, transparency, surpassing own expectations, and just kept going from one to another. We built 1,000 houses collectively in 25 villages. You know, I had no idea, but I took on the mantle of, you know, leading that charge. And I think, you know, after almost coming to 20 years, it has shown some significant impact and results that are, you know, good for our village, you know, rural disadvantaged communities. In a way, I know it's a very sad feeling to know that thousands, you know, perished. But at the same time, I guess it's like a tribute to them that we have actually developed all of this for future generations to prosper. So that's the way I look at it, from a positive angle. I think I'm generally trained to look at a positive, you know, outcome from negative surroundings. So, you know, that's the story in a nutshell. And, you know, from there, you know, I had to finish the job of, you know, reconstruction, where it went on for about 2.5 years since a tsunami struck, but put everything together. The donors were coming around. They were very compassionate. They saw us as a busing center, whatever they offered, I took it without, you know, any hesitation. Some of it I didn't even know. We have the only dental clinic in the whole of Sri Lanka, you know, relayed free of cost. And when they came and offered it to me, I didn't have any experience or expertise of oral hygiene care, you know. So, and I knew that this would be the one last time that someone is coming to your doorstep and offering a dental clinic. And I said, I can do it. They said there's no sustainable funding. And to date, I'm very pleased to announce that we see, we have seen 48,000 patients from, 48,000 patients from 28 villages. Mm. So, 48 villages and 28,000 patients.
So we're going to go a little deep into what your foundation is going to do. We are going to tell the listeners what we do here. We have Mr. Kushil Gunasekera, who is from Foundation of Goodness, and we are talking about reconciliation through welfare, empowerment, charity, and collaboration. So we continue the conversation. Let's talk a bit about the charity and the charitable work. So the empowerment project started. In Tamil, you call it Natkuna Munneta Amaipu, Foundation of Goodness. In Sinhalese, I can't pronounce Sinhalese. You can tell me in Sinhalese as well.
Yeah, Gunaja Satatapadhanama.
Certainly, and that started in 1999. The purpose is to bring, you know, the urban-rural divide, narrow down the divide, or to bridge the rural folk and urban growth. Lots of things happen. And there are so many small villages, and some of the villages you can't even go by transport. You have to go by a motorbike or even on foot or a bullock cart. Now, the total work you had done, it went, like you talked about already, the dental side of things, and you did sports work. Then, of course, empowerment projects. There are many other projects with respect to relief. Then nearly 150,000 beneficiaries, nearly 900 villages under your patronage on various ways. Tell me in chunks. So you already talked to me about the dental side of things. People eat, and if they eat, they don't, well, including me, we go to dentist only to extract a tooth. So awareness was very poor. So, you know, that particular thing was critical. People eat betel leaf and all sorts of things, and the teeth, the oral health was poor. Now, let's go with sports. You are a sports person. You played for Trinity. You played for Ananda. And you were under 19 program manager, under 19 World Cup, that is, and all sorts of things. What kind of sports-related things you had done? There are regional academies in Senegam. I heard that you have a big one. How exactly sports shapes the young people in the tiny island of Sri Lanka?
I think sports is a great team. It's, if I describe it as a very active lifestyle, leveler, because I think a lot of people in villages are roaming around without doing anything as such. So when you have sports, I think they basically come into playing sport, which actually teaches you, lots of teamwork, goodwill, unity, and brings upon a lot of peace and, active, kind of approach. You learn strategy and, so many different things that sports, helps you to build on. And I think we've been very big on sports and sporting action. So when the tsunami struck, I one thing that I had in mind is, of course, the center of excellence that we gifted, in terms of my villa that I gifted to make like a mini campus. But at the same time, I was so keen because of my own sporting background that I wanted to develop sports at rural grassroots level, so that actually, because everybody is not able to study, right? So some have talent in different areas and skill set. So we took, sports very seriously. And who would be able to fund that kind of a sports academy? And, you know, MCC, sorry, they came along and they gave us two grants, and, you know, from there, Brian Adams came to gift us the 25-meter six-lane, you know, swimming pool. And everyone, you know, too many donors, numerous donors to mention, you know. So the best thing that happened was, you know, developing this vision of a center of excellence and the sports facilities that we have, you know. And I can tell you hundreds of success stories how even women in sport has developed a huge advancement in the sports field. So, yeah, I mean, I think also for a foundation or a charitable organization, generally sports is something that is not looked upon. You know, people go with various other programs, you know, more education and vocational training and probably life skills and, you know, individual areas like children's welfare or women's empowerment or, you know, IT or what have you. But in our setup, we have, you know, all of those areas. Like at the Center of Excellence, we have about 28 different productive activities sectors. And then we also have the Sports Academy. You know, I think, like I mentioned, sports is something that, you know, lots of the boys and girls, you know, bring huge, you know, kind of productive action into their life, you know. So, and it's amazing to see the transformation of, let's say, the girls, boys who couldn't swim have become seriously good swimmers, you know, playing cricket for that matter, or playing, you know, netball, volleyball, what have you. I mean, all badminton, so table tennis. So, you know, but it's about, you know, anybody can put up something, but sustainability is the key. You know, if you can't sustain the facilities, the infrastructure that we got, which is sadly neglected by so many who, you know, very kindly donated many different programs, you know, in and around all of the tsunami hit villages, but today they are no longer in existence. So fortunately, we were able to manage it extremely well. Even if I have to say it myself, I'm sorry, but, you know, we put in some great action in terms of, you know, the management practices, the ethical processes in place, you know, systems, the standards, the quality, the discipline factor, they all came together. So that's how we run it so successfully for so many years now, coming to the, you know, 20th year post tsunami. But from where these facilities were established, it's about 17 years. So, you know, if you take our sports academy, 60 cricket teams used to come and play cricket annually in our village. You know, today, like on an annual basis, about 40 English schools and 20 Australian schools used to come and play cricket. You know, so we've had about 255 English schools and 75 Australian schools come and play cricket. And the ripple effect multiplying for the benefit of rural, you know, kids who are coming to play cricket has been phenomenal. So it's all about, you know, giving them a chance to excel in life. So when they see such a facility out there in a remote area, you know, well maintained and sustained, then, you know, they feel that, you know, we must do something. There's no one who comes there, you know, feels that I should somehow get involved in something or the other. So it's worked really well. And, you know, so I've been able to, you know, Village Heartbeat Empowerment Centers as well, you know, organize some form of sport, either volleyball or table tennis or something to that effect, just to give them an idea that education and sports has to be balanced so that you lead, you know, a pretty active lifestyle. So, yeah, I mean, that's what it is.
Sure. your website got a lot of details. When you go into women empowerment, it talks about language, health, and a livelihood. You know, they can learn some trades or some other money-making opportunities, not as money-making, but at least livelihood opportunities. Farming, and yeah, particularly it's sustainable and environmentally friendly, even to a level, a beauty parlor in Klinochi. You know, to that level, you know, things are going deep. Enterprise and businesses and skill development for young people and the women and also affected people in small villages and all. Languages and arts, it goes into details in your website, how exactly English language training is done, particularly it's a critical one. Then language between Tamil and Sinhalese is also is part of it. Then art, it's part of fitness, part of expression, and again, friendship and collaboration and learning a new thing. That goes into details. Special need children and adults are also taken care of. Sports development, you have already spoken about. Medical and dental, you have spoken about. Children and youth, that's a big project that you do in various places. There's a huge report card that was done by you for the other people so that they would know what is available and what they can do to help you, to help the needy ones. Computer literacy programs, education programs, then infrastructure development, value development, and all sorts of things. Then the major one, because of the war, because of the issues, because of other needs, the values are a bit going down. As a good Buddhist, you want to kind of build in people with good values in themselves, to respect adults, respect teachers, respect the other, respect the elderly. That is huge in your system. And you increasingly get more new people, expand your services. Then STEM, the science, technology, and technology, engineering, and maths. Increasingly, those numbers are kind of going down. So that side of things, maths and technology are critical things. Without science, you can't do much about. Then scholarships is a large part of yours. So I'm just putting a summary together so that you know, people would know the expansion you have. Then you go into environment and water. I'm a water engineer with environmental background. My high degree is in environment. So sustainability, particularly both the whole island, although in the southern part of Sri Lanka, there are lots of rivers. People don't know. There are some dry places. Some of the driest provinces are in south as well. So they need to be supported. And agricultural, particularly sustainable agriculture and agriculture for food and other crops. And I thought that work was great. And the places where you don't have good water, particularly when you have the chronic kidney diseases, they call it unidentified chronic kidney diseases. Lots of farmers, particularly men, are dying. And your organization is going into to develop, one, to take care of the patients. Second, to take care of the source so that people can have good water. Then you go to the ocean. Of course, you're life started close to the ocean. Tsunami had a big show. Coral is another one. So that side is also taken care of. All of them, I wanted to go quickly because now we had to go through briefly about the work you do in the rural side. We are not talking about Tamils and Sinhalese villages in a separate way. But when there is a foundation that is from south and you know, originated from somebody who had some Buddhist values and background, people would wonder, yeah, it's a Sinhalese or Buddhist organization, but the amount of villages your group taken care of, Sittandi, Tirukovil, Madahal, Ottuchutan, Murihandi, Palali, Palai, Pudiyanahar, and Hatton, of course, Trincomalee, these all towns, and also the upcountry towns like Muskelia and Ragala, Kodmale, and all sorts of places. There are lots of people who need help. You are working with some of the Tamil organizations as well. Can you tell us the amount of work, what kind of work you do in Tamil areas? Let's start from some of the sports grounds you are building in Tamil areas, Kushil.
Yeah, I mean, to start with, I think after the conflict, you know, concluded, you know, we decided as a team that we would go to the north from the south. By way of not only just reconciliation, but seeing the many difficulties they were in, we decided we were going to go 100 consecutive months. That was our short-term plan. Then when we went there, you know, we realized that there were so many things that were needed, and we provided everything that they wanted in the short term, then went into mid-term, then into the long term. So, right now we have 4 centers, as you rightly mentioned, in the north, about 2,500 kids, youth and women, you know, are empowered to make better progress. So maybe about 2,500 annually are being helped out by way of these 4 centers. So these centers are supported by either individual donors or by corporates. So this journey has been really, you know, very fulfilling. You know, as you had that topic of reconciliation through charity and, you know, empowerment and, you know, care and giving. So,
and collaboration, yeah.
Yeah, and of course, you know, needless to say, collaboration. Without collaboration, we couldn't have gone that far, because every time we went, we found many joining hands. You know, it's not about promising that this is what we are going to do. We went there, we made things happen, people saw, they picked us up and then joined the bandwagon. But at the same time, no one is wholly praised or blamed. But, you know, whatever the challenges we have had, we just kept going without, you know, worrying too much, because sometimes the challenges also helps you to raise the bar. And, you know, we've had lots of collaborations out there and, you know, really happy that, you know, we from the south have been able to establish these 4 centers on a permanent basis. But there were so many things, whether it fits sports, you know, we have the Murali Harmony Cup for 5 consecutive years, bringing in, you know, 16 boys teams, island-wide, 8 girls teams. You know, it was a fabulous tournament, which we had for 5 consecutive years. So, you know, it brought in a lot of reconciliation there as well. And the collaborations, like you said, you know, I mean, because I cannot forget to, you know, mention that, you know, when you go and do something without agendas and unconditionally, unexpectedly, things happen. Because I remember, you know, 1 year ago, Ranjan from One Hope, you know, calling me and saying, you know, you've done some tremendous work in the north and we need to reciprocate.
Mm.
And, you know, we would do something for the south and then he and his organization, you know, Rani Hope and Ranjan, very, very graciously and, you know, seeing again the difficulties, provided us with 10 digital smart boards, you know, for rural schools as well as for the Foundation of Goodness. So, I mean, like, let's say our women's empowerment or our sports academy or, you know, special needs unit, you know, they came up with this smart, you know, digital smart board so that we can actually train the trainers as well as the, you know, the world is at your feet with the latest techniques of management and, you know, practices that we need to adapt. And, you know, so what a good thing. And I was thinking, you know, I went there without expectations and here comes One Hope. You know, led by Ranjan and Dr. Malati and all of them together, they came and gave us, you know, 10 digital smart boards, leave alone smart boards. Some of them didn't even have computers. So we were able to, you know, install them and, you know, give them that chance to, you know, figure out what the world is doing and what those latest techniques are. You know, you call it STEM education or planetary health, or, you know, whether it's stray-friendly, you know, animal welfare programs, you know, coding, you know, so many different things. So I think it all worked out really well. Currently also, you know, we are developing the, you know, it's very interesting because I've always wanted to establish or replicate the model of the sports academy that we had in Senegal, in the north as well. We tried so many times but failed. And then, you know, I was connected to the University of Wonia. We signed an MOU. They had a lovely ground. So we went there and then started to build, you know, on the sports facilities, because I think University of Waunia, the facility is like a hub in the north, because, you know, you're close to Trincoal, Manna, then to Anuradhapura on the other side, then from here, Mount Kulam, Mulathim, and also Kilnochi. So, and I hope, you know, we are able to fulfill this aspiration of making a sports facility that I actually wish to aspire to see develop, where with high quality performance center, sports management monitoring and evaluation, you know, come up with scientific measurements and run it exactly the way I can, you know, see how developed countries like West Australia, you know, applies those techniques and tactics and strategy to take it into another level. So, you know, at this point of time, as I speak, you know, we put up a, you know, state-of-the-art gym at the University of Waunia in collaboration with One New Hope. And then, again, One New Hope did the badminton courts, indoor badminton courts, and we added one more, there were two. But we upgraded it to, you know, fairly very good standards that we see in the urban sector. And also then put up a basketball court and then went into, now I got some donors for a tennis court. And then also there are about 15 other sports that I'm working on. So I hope all those who are listening, I'm not asking for anything. I never asked anyone to, you know, donate, but I'm only saying, you know, no longer do people believe that, you know, you promise what you promise, but I think what you showcase having done, people have to believe.
Sure.
So I think seeing that, I hope, you know, the listeners out there will, you know, come up and say, okay, put their hand up and say, you know, doesn't matter what it is, but every little counts. So I'm only trying to give the best to our rural kids, because for 75 years, you know, we are still in primitive areas, you know, when you look at Colombo and the rest of the country. So, and I see the talent because that's why I'm so passionate about, you know, harnessing that skill set and talent, given the opportunity, how they can, you know, speedily accelerate to become who they are. So hopefully with everything that we've got, we have cricket coaching camps in the north. You know, we've done so many different things in villages I mean, whether it's infrastructure development or whether it's IT labs or, you know, so many different areas. So I think we're very fortunate. I mean, at the end of the day, the ultimate is also, like you very rightly said, the collaboration, the partnerships, you know, associations. So, for example, when One New Hope, you know, came along and collaborated with us, you know, I thought that's the pinnacle of, you know, real reconciliation, because here is a Tamil community, you know, team that is coming in to work with a Sinhalese community team, you know, so they work really well. And I think one of the things that we do in our 19, 20 empowerment centers is in the south, we teach actually Tamil language, and in the north, we teach Sinhalese, so that, you know, people, the future students can, you know, have that, you know, integration, interaction, and all of that stuff, because we have exchange programs as well that we bring, you know, Tamil students out to the south, and we take the south students out to the north. Yeah. So, like that, there have been so many different programs, and we completed our, as we predicted, as we promised, we completed our 100 consecutive visits to the north. Yeah, I've had my own fair of challenges. You know, be it from the north or from the south or from, you know, people, you know, in different countries, you know, so, but, you know, I never looked back and said, I'm going, I'm staying positive. And look at the outcome now in, you know, about,
starting with the young
and if you take the overall scenario, we have now 20 centers island wide, you know, 25,000 study. Free of cost, all these subjects, and including sports. And then we are almost in, last year we were in 950 villages. So, you know, and now about 850 in terms of our centers that reach out. Because each center has about 10 villages, you know, representing the student base. And I think diligently the girls are making a huge impact. And I think 58% of these center attendees are girls and 42 are boys. But so I think women's empowerment is critical, and it's shaped very well so far. So hard work is hard to beat.
Never give up. Yeah. See, the particularly I wanted to talk to you about this aspect when we had so-called embargo and North was isolated and all. Our boys and girls were using bamboo sticks for pole vault, and they did well. And when they were given instruments and apparatus by all student associations and all, a number of girls from my own school, from a rural school, Anita put the national record multiple times. She broke her own record 5 times, and soccer team, football team, my own school team won 2x the national championship, although. It is the young little girls, you know, very poor fitness, poor grounds, and all sorts of things. Opportunities. If you look at Indian cricket team, people like all those younger ones, Mohammad Shami, Mohammad Siraj, and all sorts of people, they would not come to cricket if not for the empowerment. Otherwise, it was city center in Colombo, in Sri Lanka, before Jayasurya, Kalvitarana, Malinga, and all sorts of people came from far down south. It was a challenge. Opportunities were never there. It was a Colombo-centered system. Now, now that opportunities are there, people can go and see it, videos and all the social media, people would be exposed. But without proper training to fight, you know, bowl against or bat against good players, have no grounds, proper pitch and all sorts of things, things are not going to develop. North is a challenge because we have no rain. So maintaining a ground is really, really difficult. But you know, without investment, nothing is going to happen. As a businessman, you know this. And the amount of work you do in that area is really, really appreciable. Like you said, you never ask for money. You never ask for donations. You have big people, big cricketers, and all sorts of people who open their hearts and their wallets. Wallets, not enough, you know, big checkbooks to put this, you know, to practice. But if someone thinks, wow, you know, probably I can reach this organization to seek a particular project, or maybe I can fund it and I can do it through them with the experience, they can do it. So they can always look for a foundation of goodness so they can reach you. In Australia, they can use us, though we can serve as a link. Vanny Hope is a known organization in Sydney and throughout Australia, so they can go through them to reach you. So it's really good that we had you here. But I wanted to ask you, probably in closing, as a singlish person, particularly in 2009, we had a really, really difficult end of the war. Lots of people were affected. There were parentless kids, and you know, the confidence in the system were all broken. We have no money. Country is broken, and all sorts of things. As a singlish person going into Tamil areas, how exactly you were welcomed or received? And how, I wonder, how you managed to build the confidence and, you know, take the headway, and now you are welcome into Tamil homes and Tamil organizations. How did you do it, Kushil?
You know, serving humanity is the key. It's not about serving, you know, a particular race, creed, caste, or, you know, it's about mankind. So when you see someone in difficulty, you just go out there and reach out to help. So the journey was never easy because I remember before I went, and probably once after I went, you know, I got a call from, you know, I think someone from New York who threatened me, saying that don't go to the North, your life is at risk. So I heard similar sentiments, not the same way, but you know, people in the South were also saying skeptical about my going to the North. So, you know, we had this notion that, you know, it's time that after 30 years, we need to reconcile. We need to go there and do what we can. And I'll tell you, answering to your question, Bala, you know, the first 10 months when we went and started distributing so many items that were needed immediately for relief, you know, people in the north looked the other side and accepted whatever we gave, but we were, you know, not having any expectations. It was given unconditionally. So we just kept going 1 month after the other. And I think I remember after the 10th month, you know, people began to realize that this is an organization from the south coming to the north, not stopping their journey. And therefore, now it's time to get friendly. And, you know, I did accept, you know, who are we to judge? So basically, you know, whatever we did it with utmost good faith, trust and confidence. And, you know, people began to see that we were genuine, without any agendas, and we were going and doing whatever we can. And, you know, that helped us to build bridges of friendship. You know, this just came to my mind. You know, I remember once I saw a post, you know, in a WhatsApp group, that this place called Aladi, and the 30 families were settled, and there were 130 people, and with just two toilets and one tube well. For 130 people, no one seems to have done something. You know, whatever, who are the authorities, or it's a north, it is whoever. So, and then, you know, I realized that I thought to myself, if I was in that kind of background, and I had, you know, like, you're living amidst 30 families, 132 in number, just having two toilets, and I've seen queues, you know, I was terribly moving. And then I quickly reached out to my network and put up another five toilets and four more tube wells. So that, I think, you know, it's not enough, but it relieved a huge burden to ease their, you know, despair or suffering or the sorrow. So things like that. It's about, you don't have to, you know, it's very easy to give something if you're asked. But it is not so easy to give something seeing the plight of others in difficulty or hardship. That is a superior deed, you know, giving something unasked. Giving, you know, when people ask, it's not that challenging. But, you know, it comes out of your heart, you know, that you need to basically provide. It doesn't matter where, you know, it can be in the south, it can be in the north, east, anywhere. So it's about people's struggles and hardships that you have to come to their rescue. So I'm very pleased that the Foundation of Goodness has been able to reach out, Bala, to all these areas and do what we can. I mean, you know, I'm only showcasing what we do, and we are going out there and doing the best we can for the good of others. And I know hundreds and hundreds of success stories that because we cared and because we shared to make things happen, that they have actually prospered. Whether they are grateful or not is not our concern. We have done our duty and let things flow, you know. And people, but one thing that we, I mean, everything is given free of cost, but one thing that we advocate is instilling good values. I always say education is mandatory. It can make you rich. Right? It can make you resourceful. It can make you go overseas. But it cannot only make you a happy, content person. For that, you have to learn values. You know, you have to be good, too good, and, you know, have all the nice qualities in you, and the values, you know. People don't like to see change. They cannot accept change. So you've got to embrace change and keep moving, but not let go of your values. That is the key. So, you know, we are able to keep going. And I think if I actually come back to something that you said, you know, our donor base and the network has got very wide and far by word of mouth. And that's the best form of marketing. we can do all kinds of things to do social media dress-ups and whatnot, but it's the word of mouth. It's like going to a restaurant, you know, seeing value for money, taste is good, service is great. You know, then people go word of mouth and tell, you know.
You don't need advertising.
Yeah, you don't need advertising. So that's the same, you know, whether somebody gives us $50 or whether somebody gives us $10,000, the same process. Mm-hmm. And you serve everybody in the same way. And people take you into faith, trust, and confidence. There's lots of people who are very philanthropic out there in the world. But whom to trust is the key. Mm-hmm. So once you surpass their expectations, they're going to basically, you know, spread the word amongst their circles. So that means we can do much more to the villagers who are struggling out there. I always have this battle that, you know, university students, third year, fourth year, still don't have computers. Mm-hmm. And we're not allowed to bring good condition used computers. And that, to me, is crazy. But, you know, it's a sad thing. And then, you know, we do whatever we can to provide them. And I know so many girls or boys who've cried accepting these computers. So, you know, imagine in third year, you know, not having a computer, whereas, you know, of course, yours is an advanced country. And, you know, when you're 3 years, you get your iPad. You know, that is understandable. But, you know, so things like that, you know, and I've, you know, struck this great partnership with Ranjan, Van Hope, and, you know, Dr. Maldi. And I mean, they've been the ones who've been coming to see us very often. And, you know, they are sponsoring two of our village heartbeat empowerment centers as well now, one in Odusulan, one in Tirukovil, in the East Coast. Mm-hmm. So, you know, and they are increasing their connections with us because we work at grassroots level. They also work at grassroots level. But, you know, it's a good balance. Whilst we work in the north, they are helping us in the south. So it's a beautiful feeling that, you know, your investment in goodness has not failed. Mm. So we, and my point is that in Sri Lanka, individual brilliance is unmatchable. Trust me. But collectively, we have been a disaster. So we need to get our act together and, you know, harness those talents and skill sets that we have of the rural, you know, kids, youth, and women to make, you know, our country that much more prosperous.
Beautiful. I was going to ask you to give a summary statement, but you have done wonderfully well. But in case, if you missed anything that probably you would have thought, you know, I need to talk about, but probably since I didn't ask that question, you didn't talk about any brief closing, then we can close the conversation. Kushil, it was a beautiful conversation and a lot to talk about. The 20 some, nearly 25 years of work. You can't finish it in a mere 20 to 30 minutes. But the amount of work that you do and the donors in the system, the confidence that people have in you, the credibility you have developed over the years, and going to the rural areas. And as a person, as we know, we are a pious Buddhist with all the vegetarian food habits and all sorts of things. Sorry to embarrass you, but, you know, to that level, and naturally you are from a very affluent background, all of them put together, the kind heart and helping one person to another. And a friend of mine from Matara, he always said that, a professor, he's passed now, Pubudu Davansa, he would say, this is like a chain, you know, the loops, you put another one, then the next person will put another one, the chain grows. And you are somewhere in the middle and you're doing it. I'm sure that your beneficiaries will kind of, you know, continue the favor. And there's a North American saying, let your tribe increase. People like you should grow like multiple and get the best for the children of lesser gold. And I hope, you know, your work goes really deep and wide and people respect you at the same time. They facilitate you to go further. And, you know, the young kids, people from rural areas, children without parents, families with very limited things to survive on, all of them are going to find you at some point and to get the best out. Kushil, it was so nice to talk to you. It's good to meet a person like you, and we are very honored to have you in Thayagam studio to broadcast you around the world. You are already in the system, but, you know, we are glad that, you know, we are introducing you to our listenership. Your work with Vani Hope, I hope, goes a long way as well. Thanks again.
Thank you very much. You know, thanks very much indeed for giving me this opportunity. And as I said, you know, when I started, I never expected to come to your studio or be with so many others who have supported us across Australia. You know, Australia has been really benevolent, and not to forget, of course, UK, USA and Singapore and all the European countries who have supported us. I'm very grateful. Gratitude is the best attitude. There's nothing more beautiful than going out of your way to make other lives beautiful. You know, and as I always say, think of good thoughts, say nice things, do good for others, everything comes back. You know, and greatness is never found in possessions, prestige, wealth, rather in, you know, humility, service, goodness and character. So I think it's the values that are so important in our lives. And, you know, the more we teach kids good values, you know, they're going to be content and happy rather than, you know, worry too much about and get stressed. So, you know, be good and do good and be nice to everybody, and everything comes back. So, you know, I'm very privileged and honored to have done what we did with the Foundation of Goodness. And never did I imagine that we could, in 25 years, touch close to a million, you know, hearts, empowering them the way we were able to do. And I'm very grateful to all the donors, you know, tens of thousands of them worldwide who have actually come to help us. And as I always say, gratitude, you know, is the best attitude. And, you know, if not for them, we wouldn't have been able to accomplish what we have actually reached out to the rural communities. And may all of you go from happiness to happiness and from light to light and succeed and flourish greatly, experiencing more good fortune. Thank you very much again.
Thank you very much. We had a conversation with Mr. Kushil Gunasekera, a cricketer, a philanthropist, a business owner, and a wonderful person. And it's an honor to have had this kind of conversation. Reconciliation through welfare, empowerment, charity, and collaboration. This work is never over. It is going to go further, further, and further. If anyone wants to participate in this particular process, we are more than happy to give the connection. Those who are in Australia can reach Vanny Hope. And this particular organization, Foundation of Goodness, can easily be found in the internet, and you can work through them. Whether you need something, they can consider. Whether you can do something with them, definitely they would accommodate. And if you want to donate, I'm sure that they can receive that as well. All in all, nothing is too big, nothing is too small. Together we grow. United we stand. Thank you very much, listeners. And we thank Kushil Gunasekera for this conversation, and Ranjan Sivanjana Sundaram for facilitating this. Thanks.